Key GMP drivers. What is pushing GMPs? Number one, the United States. Why? Because we are the only country in the world with no restriction on the price you can charge for drugs. I have a niche disease. I pay $30 a tablet for the disease for my disease, and I have to take one tablet every day. $30, my insurance doesn't cover me, because, quote, to them, it's experimental. My sister happens to live in Israel, and I go visit her once or twice a year, and I take my prescription there, and I can get the same tablet from the same factory in the same packaging, $1.50. It's an amazing thing, because that's the price the government says. If you want to sell in our country, that's the price. And believe me, this multinational pharma is making a good profit there as well. So be aware, everybody wants to sell in America because there are no price controls, purely and simply. So the FDA GMPs and the FDA persona of being a real tough inspectorate carries a lot of weight. And many companies overseas will try and get FDA approval, not that they really want to sell in America, but if they're approved by FDA, then they can also almost automatically be selling in about 25 other countries. Because many other countries say, FDA has approved you, good for us. Canada. Why is Canada a GMP driver? Because they happen to come up with innovative ideas more than anybody else does. Canada is a mixture of the French side in Quebec and the Anglo side in the rest of the country. I don't know if it's that or if it's the proximity to America gives them cause to have great ideas. I mentioned they were the first ones to come up with GMPs for drugs. And not only that, when they came out with them in 1959, they also included the concept of systems inspections. They divided factories into nine different systems. Every system had to pass, and every system had to pass with a grade of 70%. If any one system failed, whole factory failed. So that's, I don't know if FDA even thought about that or looked at it. They came up with the idea of classifying defects in GMP observations as critical, major, or minor. Now adopted by WHO, now adopted by PICS, yet to be adopted by FDA. Why, you say to FDA, why don't you have critical, major, minor? And the answer I've been told several times is, if we do that, people are concentrating on the critical, they'll never get to the other stuff. So if we don't tell them what's critical, major, minor, everybody will fix everything. That's one way of thinking about it. They came up with the most readable, easiest to follow, easiest to understand cleaning validation guideline. The FDA guideline on cleaning validation is a nightmare to read and understand. It's also not very good. You read the Canadian one. I've got 2000. They've actually come out with a new draft of that, much improved, 2012. It's hard to get hold of. They issue a draft. It's available on their website for 30 days. If you apply for it, they'll send it to you. Then they have another 60 days for comments, and then it vanishes until it's approved. If you can't find it on Google, send me an email. I've got it on my machine. I'll give it to you. The new one has examples, calculations, much nicer, much better. And in 2000, they came out with a process validation guideline. Now, are you all familiar with the FDA's process validation guideline of 2011? Hello? I know it's early, but hello? FDA came out with a process validation guideline that came up with the concept of three stages to validation. Number one is all the research. Number two is doing some transfer to manufacturing. And number three is the continuous monitoring annual product reviews. You're familiar with that. They didn't give any credit, but that guideline is word for word a total theft, stealing from the Canadian guideline of 10 years before. And when I spoke to Rebecca, I won't give you her last name, I don't want to embarrass, and I said, you were the editor of this. Why didn't you even acknowledge the Canadians? She went bright in the face and said, well, let's move on to the next topic. I mean, that's FDA for you. So Canada, if you want to see where things are happening, new concepts, new ideas, monitor their website. It's very good stuff. European Union is a driver, not because prices are cheap, because they control prices. America has a population of 300 million. Europe has today a population of 560. That's almost double. And if Turkey joins, it goes to 720. It's a huge number of people. So even though the price is controlled, people want to sell there. So European GMPs have impact because you have to pass a European GMP inspection. World Health Organization is a huge driver, particularly in the developing world. They have tremendous guidelines, training guidelines, and I would recommend them for use here in the States. Training guidelines on how to do all kinds of GMP aspects. Very good guidelines. I've helped write a couple of those. Their GMP base guideline is now on a par with the European Union and the PICS, but for some of their things like water and air, they're way ahead. So be aware of that. And that's, sorry, that's the tougher than those. So WHO, well worth keeping up with them. You know how FDA, by the way, you can get inspection reports from FDA? You can do the same thing on the website from WHO, and it's well worth looking at their equivalent of a warning letter called a non-compliance notice. Look at those, you'll get a lot more feel for GMP failures. There is no such thing as a full-time GMP inspectorate. They pull experts from industry, like, or consultants like myself and other GMP inspection agencies. They put together teams on an ad hoc basis. We go and inspect somewhere, we do our report, and then we disband. So that's WHO, be aware of that. And then the big one is the Pharmaceutical Inspection Cooperation Scheme, which is now 38 countries and soon gonna get up to 50. That is the real driver of inspection tactics, inspection attitudes and reports. They, for example, and they took it straight from Canada, divide their inspection observations into critical, major, and other. Critical means it's a situation likely to result in non-compliant product, or a situation that could result in an immediate or latent health risk, or an observation involving fraud, misrepresentation, or falsification of data. So, for example, the Ranbaxy scandal of 2 or 3 years ago, total fraud everywhere, that would have been a critical. FDA never said it, but it is. Ranbaxy, by the way, if you want to know about how senior management can influence a whole company's GMP profile, go into Google and look up Ranbaxy Fortune, Fortune magazine. They did an expose of the whole Ranbaxy saga. It is bedtime reading that you will weep. From the senior president, the vice presidents, corruption all the way through endemic in that company, fraudulent results, you name it, including the statement by one senior executive, we can't support any data we've sent to most countries. That's a pretty big scandal. And of course, 3 weeks ago, one of their other facilities, now in Mohali facility in India, also came under the same problems. Major observation that can result in the production of a drug not meeting its marketing authorization. In Europe and the PICS countries, you have to meet a marketing authorization, which is your NDA, and which part of it is GMP compliance. So if you don't comply with GMP, you don't comply with the marketing authorization. Other, not critical or major, but not there for GMP principles. If anybody here is an auditor, can I recommend to you to go to Canada's website where they give you examples of critical observations. And there are about 300 examples. I could only squeeze about 20 onto this slide. But if you Google the words Canada GMP observations, you'll get to that website. If you're an auditor, it is well worth doing. I mentioned that the PICS, the gem of PICS is the strategy of having inspectors jointly working together, inspectors being trained together. It would be a tragedy in the PICS world of sharing inspection reports if you have a company and today you have a Canadian inspector who goes ballistic, this is a critical observation, you are going to kill people. And then 3 weeks from now you get a New Zealand inspector who comes and says, it's not such a big problem, don't worry about it. And then a month later, a Swedish inspector comes and says, it's a concern, I would not worry about it, but it's not critical. So where do you stand? It'd be three different attitudes for the same observation. So they are very, very much into training inspectors to have the same attitude, the same interpretation of a GMP observation. And that's what they do. So they have annual training programs, and here's the ones for the last few years. I've taught at a couple of them. And the best thing about this is, it's closed to everybody but inspectors. However, the best thing, 6 months later, you can get a copy of the entire proceedings, all the training programs, all the things they discussed, it's all available. It costs you 40 Swiss francs. You get on the website, you download it, but it's 40 Swiss francs, well worth reading where the trends are, where their inspection prospects are. If you're in the API business, there was one on APIs, it's somewhere here. Inspection of APIs, there you go. And they repeat these, so this one from APIs is coming up in 2 years' time again. All right, so that's their joint training program to make sure all inspectors do things the same. They also do joint inspections. I recently had a Japanese company that had a joint inspection, a PICS inspection with an Australian, a Israeli guy, and a Canadian guy. The three together doing a joint inspection to make sure that they could check each other off, that they did all have the same attitude. So that's more and more happening. PICS has lots of guidelines, very well worth reading, GMPs for drugs, GMPs for APIs. And then they have also aid memoirs, which are inspection checklists. If you're going to inspect a biotech company, these are the things to look for. If you're going to inspect an API company, these are the things to look for. It's called an aid memoir, loosely translated as a memory jogger. It's not a checklist, but it's things to consider when you go walking around and doing your audits. The difference between GMPs and ICH, because some people get confused, GMPs tell you what needs to be done. Here's the GMP, you shall have X, Y, and Z. ICH tells you how to do it, because GMPs will tell you you have to validate your analytical methods, but it doesn't tell you how to do it. You want to know how to validate an analytical method? Go to ICHQ2. Everything's there. You don't need to ask any more questions. The trouble is they don't do it for everything. They're getting on the program, but they don't do it for everything. So major things, stability studies, GMPs for APIs, validation, that's ICH. They're getting to expand more. Hello? And if you're interested, go to that website, ICH.org, and click on the queue for quality, and you'll see all of their quality guidelines, which cover stability, analytical validation, impurities, assessing them and determining how to the limits of them, biological quality, specifications. I mentioned those GMPs, and then these are the newest ones, what they call the quality vision, which is the biggest influence on GMPs in the world today. All right, and you can go through those yourself, you can see that. So that was drug GMPs. Anybody got questions so far?